We have been set apart to belong to him. Come out from among them and be separate, and I will be your dad, and you'll be my children. This is what he calls us to.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I'm well. How are you?
I am as good as can be expected.
Yeah. Okay, Grandpa. So tell us just the latest, because people are praying and listening.
Thank you so much. First of all, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for praying. It's been wonderful to get so many messages of support and people praying, and just we feel the love, man. It's been wonderful. Progress for Henry is that he's up and down. He's generally overall positive, things doing well. The big news this week was they did a brain scan and he didn't have any severe brain bleeds or anything. So they don't even need to do that for another few weeks, I guess.
Praise the Lord. Yeah.
So he's progressing well in that. He's had a couple little hiccups with the breathing stuff, and they started doing some antibiotics yesterday, I guess, because it looked like he might be developing an infection of some sort. And that's kind of the main concern now, is trying to fight off infections. So it's a roller coaster ride. I mean, everybody that's been through the NICU experience with the baby says it is a roller coaster. The emotions just, I mean, from one minute to the next, because they're, and if you think about it, like what God created to work so wonderfully in the womb is, you know, they're trying to recreate that in this artificial environment out of the womb, you know? And so it's constantly it's amazing watching, you know, these brilliant doctors and nurses tweaking things and trying to make it be as wonderful an environment to grow a baby in, but it's clumsy and doesn't work as well as it should, you know, or as well as we'd like it to. So,
yeah. Well, God bless you and your wife and your daughter and her husband and all the siblings. Wow.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know the last thing that I remember seeing prayer requests was about infections. Yeah. So I've been praying about that off and on throughout the day. Whenever Henry comes to mind, God deliver that boy from infection. Mm-hmm. Keep him safe. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. So today we're going to talk about anointing, and we're going to do a little bit different order, because normally what I would do is I would start right in Exodus, and we would talk about Exodus chapter 40, where the priests were anointed and set apart for their service, not only the priests, but the tabernacle as well. But I'm just going to back up a little bit, because most of us are probably most familiar with anointing when it comes to anointing kings, like Saul, David, Solomon, etc. So let's pray. Father, thank you for the anointing which you initiated. You directed Samuel to anoint. You directed kings to be anointed. And there's a lot to it in the scripture, but I pray that you'll give us fresh eyes to see what you have ordained and what you've called into being and what you've set apart, not only for kings and priests, but for all of us. So give us eyes to see what you want us to see today and ears to hear what your spirit has for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Samuel took the flask of oil, poured it on his head, this was Saul, kissed him and said, "Has not Jehovah anointed you a ruler over his inheritance?" This is 1 Samuel 10. And five verses later, it says, "The Spirit of Jehovah will come upon you mightily, and you shall prophesy with them and be changed into another man." So there's a little picture that we have of Samuel anointing Saul. The word for anoint is mashach. And there's not only, for those of you that want to go a little deeper and study yourself, you'll find mashach, and you'll find words for anoint, anointing, anointed. You'll find a couple words in the Aramaic that are close to it. But here's what we see in Samuel and Saul. A man of God took a flask of oil, poured it on his head. Now that's a picture right there, this pouring of oil upon his head. In this situation, Samuel was setting apart Saul to be the king. He was setting him apart for a calling. He was to be a king. This was his office. He was consecrated. That's what consecrated means, set apart. This was going to be his job. Okay, and oil is a picture of the Spirit of God, because as you saw, Samuel anointed him, he poured it on his head, and then it says, then the Spirit of Jehovah will come upon you mightily. And oil and the Spirit, they go together. It just is. And so if we just hold those thoughts together, pretty much everywhere where we're reading, there's not going to be a lot of divergence from this. It's an anointing. It's the Spirit of God coming upon a person, setting them apart for an office, consecrating them to do the work of God. 1 Samuel 16, we know Saul dropped the ball, so then God directed Samuel to go to Jesse. I just like reading the scripture, so I'll read verses 11 through 13. Samuel said to Jesse, "Are these all the children?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, and behold, he's tending the sheep." Then Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." So he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, with beautiful eyes and a handsome appearance. And Jehovah said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is he." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of Jehovah came mightily upon David from that day forward. We've talked about David many times in these podcasts. David was already, as we just read, he was handsome, he was a faithful shepherd, etc. But he became a new man that day because the Spirit of Jehovah came upon him. And we know that it anointed not only his whole being, it anointed his music. And then his first role in Saul's court was to drive away evil spirits by his anointing, which he'd received. So there's the oil, there's the Spirit, there's a consecration, a setting apart. What has struck me probably more times than I can count is how David honored the anointing. I'm going to put it that way. 1 Samuel 24:10, and this expression is used several times. We know that Saul was jealous of David, and even when David delivered them from Goliath and the Philistines, he chased him, he hounded him, he tried to kill him many, many times. But in 1 Samuel 24:10, David said, "This day thine eyes have seen how Jehovah had delivered thee into my hand in the cave. And some said I should kill you, but mine eyes spared you. And I said, I will not put forth my hand against my Lord, for he is Jehovah's anointed." And that expression is used several times. David respected the anointing. He honored what God had done. Even though this man was trying to kill him, he was clearly out of control. He was not being led by God's Spirit. David, nonetheless, respected the anointing. And I'm just saying it because I still don't comprehend it fully. If it was me, that guy's chasing me around trying to kill my family and me, I'd have taken him out. But anyway, David respected the anointing. And then David himself, when Saul did die, he was anointed several times. First, he was anointed to be king in Judah, and then over all Israel. What God said about David, Psalm 89, 19 through 20, "I have exalted one chosen out of the people. I have found David my servant. With my holy oil have I anointed him." Psalm 89 is, as much as I can't comprehend how David could continue to respect and honor Saul because of the anointing, Psalm 89 continues to be one of those psalms that I pretty much take off my feet when I get close to. It's sublime. And God says, I found my boy. I found David, and I have set him apart, and I've consecrated him with my holy oil. And David's obituary, if you want, reads this way in 2 Samuel 23:1. These are the last words of David, the oracle of David, the son of Jesse, the oracle of the man who was raised on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the sweet psalmist of Israel. That's what it's on his tombstone. The anointed of the God of Jacob, the sweet psalmist of Israel. So as wonderful as David probably was with natural giftings and all the rest, it was the Spirit of God that came upon David that made him who he was. And there's none like him besides Jesus, which is worth reading next, because Jesus was described in Isaiah 61:1, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because Jehovah has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, etc. Wonderful passage quoted almost word for word in Luke 4:18, when he himself said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. And Peter, when he was giving a history lesson in Acts chapter 10, verses 37 to 38, you yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And then in the book of Hebrews, we read, first chapter, eighth verse, of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. So there's these wonderful pictures from the Old Testament about Christ himself, which means anointed, the word Christ. And now let's go back to the nation of Israel. 1 Chronicles 16, these are the instructions to the priest. 1 Chronicles 16 has become one of my favorite chapters in the whole Old Testament. But there is a little chunk in here where it says, when you were few in number, of little account, and sojourners in it, wandering from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another people, he allowed no one to oppress them. He rebuked kings on their account, saying, touch not my anointed ones. Do my prophets no harm. Israel was called the anointed ones. Okay, so the whole nation, as we've said many times, God's original purpose for them was that they would be a holy people. They would be his people. They would be taken out, you might say, all the nations of the earth and set apart, consecrated to be a holy people, his people, a kingdom of priests. This is what he had on his heart from the beginning. But even within that holy nation, he had specific people set apart to be priests. And there are several places we could read in Numbers, Leviticus, the beginning of Exodus. I chose one big chunk to represent them. Exodus 40, verses 9 through 15. You shall take the anointing oil and anoint the tabernacle and all that is in it, and consecrate it and all its furniture, so that it may become holy. You shall also anoint the altar of burnt offering and all its utensils, and consecrate the altar, so that the altar may become most holy. You shall also anoint the basin and its stand, and consecrate it. Then you shall bring Aaron and his sons to the entrance of the tent of meeting, and shall wash them with water, and put on Aaron the holy garments, and you shall anoint him and consecrate him, that he may serve me as priest. You shall bring his sons also, and put coats on them, and anoint them as you anointed their father, that they may serve me as priests, and their anointing shall admit them to a perpetual priesthood throughout their generations. There is so much packed in there, But what I heard and what I saw as I was reading this was this anointing oil was not only for the priests, Aaron and his sons, it was for the very tabernacle itself and its furniture and its offerings and the altar and the basin. All of it was to be set apart, consecrated, anointed with oil. I think that's something that we don't maybe take in as much as we realize that places can be special. Things can be special, not just people, because the tabernacle and all of its furnishings, utensils were to be set apart. They were to be anointed. And it's just quite a picture to me. And in my head, I'm jumping ahead because I know that God tells us in Corinthians, you shall be a holy people. It's the same idea. We have been set apart to belong to him. Come out from among them and be separate, and I will be your dad, and you'll be my children. This is what he calls us to. And so 2 Corinthians 1, verses 21 and 22 say, he who establishes us with you in Christ and anointed us is God, who also sealed us and gave us the Spirit in our hearts as a pledge. You see all these same words being used. We're being anointed. We're being recipients of the Spirit of God. We're being covered with oil. And frankly, I saved the best for last. These are the passages that as God put on my heart, priests have been anointed. I didn't go in my mind to Numbers or Exodus. I went to 1 John chapter 2. And there are two verses here, one in the 20th verse, one in the 27th verse. You, plural, have been anointed by the Holy One, and you have all knowledge. Gasp. 27th verse. As for you, the anointing which you received from him abides in you, and you have no need for anyone to teach you, just as his anointing teaches you about all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you abide in him. It's a beautiful picture, but God has anointed us. Just take that one thought from those two passages. We have been anointed, and his anointing, his Spirit coming upon us, being poured out on us, is teaching us everything we need to be taught. And it's ongoing, and it's an abiding thing, and he's given us knowledge, he's given us insight. It's no one but the Spirit of God has been leading us down this path as we've been studying what it means to be consecrated, to be set apart, to be a priest unto the Lord. And just a quick overview, these priests, us, we've been set apart, consecrated, anointed, filled with the Spirit to do the work of God, to minister to God and his people, to pray and make sure that his house is a house of prayer, to seek God, to give thanks to God, to be warriors for God, to believe the work of God, to resist the enemy, to worship, bless, stand by him, clothed in him, bearing on our hearts the people of God. It's a glorious picture, but as high a calling as this is, it's not beyond the anointing. The anointing is what will teach us and help us to do what God has called us to do. Amen?
Amen.
Poor Scott. He's just trying to keep his grandson alive, and I'm dropping these big bombs on him.
Well, that passage in 1 John, I mean, that packs a punch, man. I don't feel like I'm living like that most days. I don't know if I've ever felt like I'm living in that kind of power. And that makes me want to figure something out here. Like that, the anointing you received from him remains in you. You do not need anyone to teach you, but as his anointing teaches you about all things, and as that anointing is real, not counterfeit, just as it has taught you, remain in him. Like, that's powerful.
It's extremely powerful. Okay. So I think I've been helped. I really have. Yeah, I mean, I didn't know how to put this together, but I think the Spirit helped us this morning. But when you think about this calling, you have to consider not the calling, but get your eyes back on the caller and the anointing that he's given us to do it. It's all about him, and his Spirit comes upon us. And I wouldn't be doing justice to Scripture if I didn't close by reading about two people that were specially consecrated, set apart, filled with the Spirit, and that is the people that are called the two anointed ones. So I'm going to read these passages, two big chunks from Zechariah chapter 4, because this, I believe, is very near at hand. The angel who talked with me came again and woke me, like a man who is awakened out of his sleep, and he said to me, "What do you see?" I said, "I see, and behold, a lampstand, all of gold, with a bowl on the top of it, and seven lamps on it, with seven lips on each of the lamps that are on the top of it. And there are two olive trees by it, one on the right of the bowl and the other on its left." And I said to the angel who talked with me, "What are these, my Lord?" Then the angel who talked with me answered and said to me, "Do you not know what these are?" I said, "No, my Lord." Then he said to me, "This is the word of Jehovah to Zerubbabel, not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith Jehovah of hosts." Now that's a familiar passage we often hear mentioned, and it ought to be mentioned. It's wonderful. But here's the context. It's about these two olive trees. And then down in the 11th verse, "What are these two olive trees on the right and the left of the lampstand?" And a second time I answered and said to him, "What are these two branches of the olive trees which are beside the two golden pipes from which the golden oil is poured out?" He said to me, "Do you not know what these are?" I said, "No, my Lord." Then he said, "These are the two anointed ones who stand by the Lord of the whole earth." And they're mentioned again in Revelation. These are the two anointed ones. These are the people that are standing for God. These two people, these anointed ones, these people who have been consecrated, called out, filled, poured out on their head oil, are not only receiving the anointing, but they are pouring oil into these lampstands. And it looks to me, as I read Revelation, it'll be Christ and the two anointed ones, and then it will be the Antichrist and beasts and all his minions. It's going to be a clear-cut battle, but I'm on the team of the two anointed ones because we're going to be standing with them. How's that?
Amen.
Yeah, that's a good answer. I don't know either. Yeah. I'm just simply believing the word of God and thanking him. Father, thank you for your anointing. Thank you for the anointing that Jesus received and which made him the Christ, the anointed one. Thank you for the anointing that David received that helped him to be the sweet psalmist of Israel, the anointed one of God. Thank you for the anointing that Aaron and his sons received for a perpetual priesthood. And thank you for the anointing which we received. And these two special people that we read about in Zechariah and Revelation, these anointed ones, they're in the earth today. God bless them. God encourage them. And God bless all of us who are in the same work of standing by the Lord of the whole earth, ministering to you, ministering to each other, teaching, believing, worshiping, all these things we've articulated. Thank you for the anointing. Help us to count on it, reckon it, believe in it, and walk in the power of it. In Jesus' name. Anoint us afresh today, all of us that are listening, and even if we're not listening, anoint your people today to be all that you've called us to be, a people that stand by the Lord of the whole earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at Scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.